Welcome to another episode of Conversation and Cocktails with your host, me, Lenny B. This week, we speak to tattoo artist Steve Huie. Steve is not only a fantastic tattoo artist, but he's also a graphic artist. He's responsible for about, I'd say, 90% of the work on my body. We sat down with Steve, talked from everything from tattoos, to art, to music, to life in general. So, roll that fucking footage.
Look at this. Who's that chicken?
Look,
chicken lip. Who's that?
Look, fucking, you are obsessed with your dog. Let me tell you.
I do not know. He's an awesome dog. Everyone loves him.
Yes, they do. It's the only dog I know. There are other pets, but don't want Instagrams. You know, I'm sure he has what, like 300 followers at this point.
Something like that.
Oh, Jesus fucking Christ! Get out of here. So, see what?
Yes.
What got you into wanting to like? Do tattoos, draw. What was...
Draw. I was growing up, and I thought everybody knew how to draw.
Really?
Apparently, not everybody knows how to draw. And, so I was that kid that got in trouble drawing teachers all, like, messed up looking, pretty...
Oh, you were the one, like, oh, Mrs. Smith, I'm going to...
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm gonna accentuate whatever the fuck.
Right, your nose is huge, so your nose can be even bigger, you know? Alright, this guy wants to go.
Yeah.
Later. Bye, chicken.
So as far as that went, you know, were you into the whole tracing comic book characters?
Yes, I traced comic books. Well, I collected comic books. And then I wanted to be a comic book artist. I wanted to draw superheroes, I wanted to draw monsters. And I loved it, right? But so I went to like art and design. I met everybody else in class who had the same interests as I did, right? And met a lot of people who were really, really good. And I was just like, man, this is not for me then, you know? I can't compete with these guys.
I mean, at that point, like, what was your favorite comic book character to draw?
That was Wolverine.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Would you say that you were, like, a comic book nerd?
To a point.
You know.
Yeah.
were you that kid in high school cutting class and going down, like, Forbidden Planet? Well, yes. Back then, you gotta remember, New York was a lot different. There was so many, like, little basement mom-and-pop shops.
Mm-hmm.
You know, where you would just dig through boxes. Because yeah. I remember when I was growing up, like in the 80s, like every other block had the comic book store.
Yeah.
You know, and you just fucking, the rent, you know, like I collected G.I. Joe comics. That was my thing. I have 1 through 50 in like mint condition.
Mm.
You know, I probably have like 4 number ones just because it's like, you know, now they're worth about $80 a piece, you know, in mint.
Yeah.
You know, but that. I wasn't really the biggest comic book guy. I just liked war and history. Mm-hmm. So I was like, oh, G.I. Joe, you know, and had all the toys growing up because,
right.
You know, that was, you know, it's like kind of like when, you know, we all had the Star Wars toys growing up.
Right.
You know, and unfortunately, I had actually every first run Star Wars toy. We had kept it stored in a friend's place in Brooklyn when I was a kid, and it got broken into, and I lost everything. X-Wing, Millennium Falcon, fucking, you know, the Death Star playset.
Right, right.
I was like so pissed off. I was like, oh, you fucking, you know, I think about it now. It's like, oh, I could have fucking, that shit's worth money.
That shit's worth money, and it's
also a childhood thing, of course,
a lot of memories. It's really nostalgic, but it's,
Well, you went to, what, SVA?
Yeah, oh, I went to School of Visual Arts after I went to High School of Art and Design, and... I continued. I went into illustration. Also, you know, majoring in cartooning. So,
Did you finish college?
Yeah, I did. I got a bachelor's degree.
Really?
Yeah.
I can't. You know, no offense. I can't picture you with a. Well, that's not true. You know, that's not true. You know, it might be the Asian thing or a successful type of person.
Right.
But I just, you know, knowing you, I. You know, I could see you being like, I don't need this shit, fuck this, I'm out of here, you know? I mean, but what was the transition from, like, wanting to be you know, a graphic artist into tattooing? How does that, like, transpire?
Kind of worked out. Got you good, huh? Well, I was getting tattooed at the time, and a lot of my friends were getting tattooed. I was getting tattooed by Chris Garver, and we had a lot of discussions and talks with about, you know, the art of it, the technicalities of it, and we were really good friends. And I was like, you know, I kind of want to get into it. I kind of want to see how far this can take, you know. But what if you fuck up? It's, you're tattooing, you know, you're gonna mess up. And Chris is like, no, you know, I'm here. I can help you, you know, whatever questions you have. So that was a big boost of confidence right there. That kind of made me feel I can kind of do it. So also just watching him tattoo me, I just learned a lot. I mean, it's a big difference. Well, it's a, watching it doesn't mean you can do it, you know? Yeah. you ask enough questions the right way, and you can probably get the right answers eventually, and, you know?
And you and Chris are still friends.
Oh, we're still friends, and he's still tattooing me. We've been working on my bodysuit over 25 years now, you know?
What studio was that out of?
He was at Fun City, and still there, you know?
Fucking March. Jonathan Shaw's joint?
Yeah, you know?
Before we go any further, that's another thing. I looked this up the other day, because I was like, because I remember, you know, my first tattoos, and you've gone over them. Yeah. You know, almost all my work has been done by Steve, with the exception of a handful of pieces. And back in, you know, for nobody that knows, and, you know, there are guys that are a lot younger than me who now just go to shops. Mm. When you got tattooed, you had to go to somebody's apartment. Mm-hmm. For the most part. There were exceptions, like, I still don't know how Fun City, because I remember when, back in the late 80s, Fun City was open, and I was like, yeah. And you knew tattooing was this outlaw thing, mm-hmm. you know, and it's like, how the fuck is he open and it's illegal? But at the same time, I think the cops, to be really honest, you had bigger fish to fry in the city. You know, we're going to go into the crack thing and, you know, 3,000 murders a year. You know, I think it's like tattoos, you know, most cops got tattooed, so,
right.
You know, they weren't going to fucking come down on it. But, you know, during that point, you had to go to somebody's apartment, you know, mm-hmm. to fucking go get tattooed. And, you know, sometimes it was a shady fucking situation, as I learned on a handful of my early tattoos, you know. It's like, wow, it's... place is kind of grungy, and I mean, when you started, you were an apartment tattooist, weren't you?
I tattooed out of my apartment in the beginning, for sure, you know.
You did you apprentice at all, or no?
No, it was a weird, I kind of did everything the way you're not supposed to. I did a lot of artwork. I was doing a lot of art for bands already, so I kind of had people who knew my work already, so they were like, all right, I'm willing to let you tattoo me, you know, because I guess you can draw, you know, at the time.
Yeah.
There was a lot of friends who got tattoos, and there were a lot of friends who were like, all right, I'm down, I'll let you tattoo me, you know. You know, and I'm grateful to have friends like that to even, like, to give me my beginning, you know. It was really, really cool.
How nervous were you, like, the first time you sat down and actually put the needle to somebody else?
I was so nervous. It was on my friend, on Rat Bones. That was my very first tattoo. And it was in Jersey City at my friend's house, and I had a friend there who did tattoos as well, so he kind of gave me a guiding guiding hand a little bit, just to be like, all right, this is what you're doing wrong. This is what you're doing, you know, right. So, so I felt okay with that. But it took 4 hours to do an outline of a dragon head on his calf. Okay, so normally something like that would take maybe 15 minutes.
Yeah.
It took me 4 hours. I was sweating. I was nervous. I was just, I just wanted to make sure the lines are right, and like having the machines up. Like I didn't know if it was on or off. I didn't know whether it was tuned or not. It just, if it had a spark, it was sparking up pretty loud, you know.
And I mean, after that, because when I started getting tattooed by you, it was down at was it Rising Dragon on 23rd, and I don't remember how I got introduced to you. I think it might have been Armando, might have been Warren or somebody else like that. And it was because I had a lot of incompleted pieces from a guy who apparently had, you know, it was like he got into an accident and is like, I'm never tattooing again. He wound up tattooing years later, but and I was like, well, you know, I got you know, some outline work. It was like, you want to do something with this? You know, it's like, and you know, 20 years later, I'm still fucking getting tattooed by the same guy. You know, which that says a lot, though, because when you find an artist you could trust, you know, I mean, everyone, you're always gonna go outside the box, and you know, like, hey, I'll let you try this, I'll let you try that, you know, what the fuck?
Yeah,
why not?
We have a relationship now. It's not like
just
a, oh, I just met you. Can you do this? Can you do it the right way? You know, and I'm still tattooing over 20 years now, so I hope, you know, that I'm doing something right, you know.
Yeah. Well, that wasn't your first shop that you worked out of, was it?
The first shop I worked at was in Long Island. It's a place called Body Designs.
Is it still there?
No. Well, the shop that I worked at is no longer there. I believe the because they had a few shops. The original one is still open, but the one that I worked at is no longer there.
Mm.
That was in Hicksville. So I was there for about a year or so. 94, but then I got a call from my friends that worked at Rising Dragon. So, and they're like, hey, we have a seat available. So would you like to kind of come out and work in Manhattan? Which was great for me, because I lived in Astoria at the time. So as opposed to taking a train out to Long Island every day, I would take the subway to
Manhattan. It's a lot more money in your fucking pocket.
Right, too, and absolutely. And the thing is that I just wanted to learn. You know, I'd never really had a formal apprenticeship.
Yeah.
So my whole thing was going to places where they had really good tattoo artists, where I can kind of pick their brain and watch, you know, watch and learn and still continue to improve on the craft. So that was a big deal for me, you know. Along the way, I was learning how to make needles, I was learning how to tune machines, and just basically how to put in a clean line, you know. So I kind of learned the hard way. I didn't do the proper apprenticeship like I should have, you know, because it wasn't really available. It was really hard to kind of come by, you know.
Well, in this day and age, I mean, do you have guys at your shop that are apprenticing under you guys right now, or anyone that you've had? Or you kind of stray away from that a little bit?
Yeah, because there's so many people tattooing nowadays, you kind of, you don't want to create your own competition.
Yeah.
You know? But you also want to, at the same time, the people that do want to learn, they kind of have to earn that place to say, okay, you can trust me enough, or I can learn this from you. It's interesting in my position now. I was always like, you know, you kind of like have to keep this kind of protected, you know, because there's a lot of people who think they know what they're doing, and they're kind of destroying all this, you know, everybody around you. So I mean, I do a lot of cover-ups now because of it. But when you want to do when you want to teach somebody, you want to teach like all the right way.
Yeah.
You know, all the correct, you know, beliefs and values, you know.
What's your feeling? Because I've been seeing these now pop up, is, you know, tattoo schools, and it's basically like a it's like a place in a strip mall with cubicles.
Yeah.
You know, and you get a certificate of completion, and it's just like, really? You know, because I mean, I know guys who, nobody that's ever done that, but I also know guys that sort of done what you've done, you know, where they did an apprentice, they've done it at an apartment for a while, and, you know, a lot of them have practiced on themselves, you know, usually in the upper thighs, you know, fucking just like, ow, 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 you know, or what, another way you could practice what you were saying before was, potato skins.
Yeah, potato skins, honeydew melon, pork, pig skin.
Pig so, skin?
Yeah.
Chickens and turkeys.
Yeah, but that's mostly to get yourself familiar with the machine.
Yeah.
Like the vibration, the weight, you know. There's a wire kind of coming off.
Yeah. It.
You know, it's new. So how to make a line.
But what's your feeling on these tattoo schools?
I think it's I think it's terrible. You can't do that. You know, that's disrespecting the trade. It's disrespecting the people, the history of it. Because these people are doing it for the money. They're not doing it for the spirit. You know, for the people that are really wanting to do it, you know.
In other words, they lack that passion. They just see it as a dollar.
Yes, and it's disrespectful to the people that are already. Correct, because if you're gonna graduate from that school, where you're gonna go? No shop's gonna hire you. You know, you're gonna say, "Oh, I graduated from this school. I'm gonna work at your shop. I'm gonna make money for you." You know, but you're not doing it the right way. You're not giving respect to the people around you, even the people that are already in the business, you know, their clientele. You know, you're not gonna steal, you're gonna hire someone to take business away from the guy next to you.
Yeah, you know? Well, they're gonna wind up being the shop.
Yeah.
You know, you know, just like, you know, in my line of work, we have apprentices.
Right.
And, you know, they get.
You gotta earn it.
If you want it, you gotta earn it. And right. It's the same thing. It's like, you know, people be like, well, why do I have to do this? It's like, shut your fucking mouth and do it. Mm-hmm. You know, don't ask questions, because in 3 years or what, you know, in our business, it's a 3-year apprenticeship. You go in, you take shit. I had to take shit. The guy below me now has to take shit. And it's just, you know, it's an underclassman thing where it just, shit rolls downhill. I dealt with it. You're gonna deal with it. Well, do I have to deal with it? It's like, you know, it's like, well, shut your fucking mouth and deal with it. It's like, you want to make money. This is what you have to fucking do.
Right.
You know, you don't like it. Well, you can work at McDonald's or Burger King.
Right.
You know, it's not the most glamorous job in the world, but there you go.
But the thing is, like, everybody's been through it. Everybody who's worth anything has been through, like, the grunt period. You know. That's kind of where I kind of wish I had an apprenticeship so I could say I did this, but I did it a different way. But in my heart, I still had the respect for it. I needed to do it the right way.
Well, I always felt that you were humble about how you approach things. You know, it wasn't like, because I've met some other tattoo artists, you know, who I've not gotten work from, but they're very cocky about, you know, like, well, I'm so-and-so. And it's like, that's great. It fucking still looks like shit, you know? We're talking about tattoo schools, you know, I mean, and, you know, what about the reality shows? I mean, I know you've had friends of yours on these reality shows.
Oh, sure.
You know, and again, nothing wrong with it, but I also know I have neighbors of mine in my building who film and edit reality shows, and everything is... There is nothing reality about reality shows. There's a lot of scripted stuff.
Of course.
You know, because if you sit there and, like, if they were to come into your shop and film you, like, my job. You know, you know, you'd hear a few conversations and get bored after about fucking a couple days. You know, be like, it's like, yeah, well, this is called work. It's work, you know, at the end of the day. I think, you know, I'm definitely sure there are dramas that are set up.
Well, it's also, it's entertainment.
Yes.
You know? So it's not like you're sitting there, all right, I'm going to watch you draw some lettering on some guy. They want to capture drama, you know? I mean, I had the privilege or the opportunity to know a lot of these people and to kind of even work at a shop where they did film a show.
Oh, Worcester Street.
At Worcester Street.
Yeah.
And I had a great time there. I met some really great people. I mean, I understand the other side of it where a lot of people look all frown upon reality shows as disrespecting the craft and the business. But I know the guys that work on the show and they have nothing but respect for the craft. And they're actually really good people.
Do you feel though that opened up the door for some of these tattoo schools?
Of course.
You know, because again, anything you see on TV, people go, "Oh, I could do this." Yeah. You know, and it's another way for somebody else to go make money. You know, and it's like, well, just because you're paying some guy to learn the trade,
right?
You're not actually. You may get to that point at some point. Chances are, you're just going to fail.
Yes.
You know, and I think most of those people who go to tattoo schools tend to, you know, they go, oh, well, this isn't the life for me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my back hurts, my hands
hurt. Oh, yeah. It's definitely not as glamorous as people tend to believe sometimes.
Well, that's just the way.
Well, the job hurts. I mean, you work crazy hours.
Yeah.
You know, it's when you're off from work, you still work.
Yeah.
Like I'm at home. I have to draw, for the next week or the next appointment. It's.
Well, you're definitely you keep yourself busy.
I mean,
that's another thing we're gonna shift into in a minute is the music thing.
Okay.
You know, as far as like. You know, music. What was the music you grew up with? Like, your earliest musical, experience that you had?
Well, the first tape that I bought was the Fat Boys.
Really?
I bought the Fat Boys? Yeah.
So, like, 1985?
Something like that. Yeah. It was the Fat Boys and Twisted Sister.
Okay.
Right? So those two tapes.
Wait, at the same time?
Yeah.
Those are two totally different ends of the spectrum. You know, like, it's like Fat Boy Switch the Sister.
Yeah, we're on Steinway Street, and there was a record store right next to Yogi Lala's. I forgot what it was called.
Jolly's Joint?
Was it Jolly's Joint? I think it was Jolly's Joint.
Jolly's Joint sold.
It was across the street the other
way. Wait, the same side as the movie theater? A couple doors down.
That was Jolly Joint, right?
Yeah, it was next to the Odd Job.
Right.
You know, or Job Lot.
It was a music store. Yogi Lala, and then the movie theater, and then Jolly Joint. But there was a record store right next to it. I bought those tapes there.
I mean, obviously the Fat Boys, because you probably had...
Because we were beatboxing.
Yeah.
Me and my brothers were beatboxing, and that was also really big on the radio, because we were
Jesus Christ. Where does your record collection go?
So,
you know, like, I'm serious, like, because you're two totally ends of the spectrum.
Yeah.
That only lasted
so long with the Fat Boys, right? Because where I grew up, or elementary school, they're all, you know, the brothers. Like, I had friends that all lived in the projects. We all loved it, you know, and that's what they listened to. And that also, the other side is all the metalhead kids, whatever. Twisted Sister was really, really, it spoke to me.
Yeah.
You know? And.
What was it, the Stay Hungry record?
Yeah.
Stay Hungry, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that said a lot to me, and I loved it. So metal, spoke to me at a very early age.
Yeah. You know?
So, So since then, like, Twisted Sister, Quiet Riot, you know, and kind of built up from there. But, what was it, 85, 86, Metallica.
Yeah.
Of course, you know. And then you open to, oh shit, Black Sabbath. And then, you know, Black Sabbath, well, first, because you hear that, Twisted Sister. And then you kind of stay with the, then you meet all the, like, the metalhead kids in school. So they all, like, had, like, all the scary shirts. And then just want to let my hair, you know, let my hair grow. And I was basically metalhead, you know. But who, all my friends in junior high school, like, I met Ezek and you met all this all the kids there. So you, like, you know, everyone had the group of friends that were into like heavier stuff. So it's, then all those kids were, and actually I was like the long haired kid amongst all these like skinhead kids. So it was, and then we all had the same friends, with my brothers, and we all kind of hung out together. So it's pretty funny, and that really kind of, because they all started playing music as well. So it was all around that.
And then on top of that, you're just kind of, you know, recommending music to one another.
Yeah.
You know, how at that point, how, like, especially when the Metallica thing came in and the Pusshead arc came in.
Yes.
I mean, was that one of those things like, oh shit, I.
Oh shit, this spoke to me.
Yeah, know? It was like, I gotta do that.
This is my fucking guy, you know, Pusshead. Because like I was telling you, I grew up on comic books. So everybody had a certain way of drawing. You know, you look at John Byrne and Terry Austin, that crew, John Romita, like, and Frank Miller. They all had a certain look to how the figure is supposed to be drawn, the pen and ink stuff. Then you look at Pusshead stuff, all the punk rock stuff, and his line was completely different, you know? So that kind of opened my eyes to, like, whoa, you know, how come he draws so funky and still kind of get away with it, you know? And he drew skulls with his shit, you know, so.
And then he also did a ton of skateboard decks.
Yes.
My God. Fucking anyone who fucking skateboard at that time, you had the fucking fat boards and the fucking short tails
and the Zorlock boards were all shaped all funny. So they're like, oh, you know, what the fuck is that? But to see, all right, who drew that? It's Pusshead. And then oh shit, my friend's got a Damage Incorporated shirt from Metallica. Who drew that? Pusshead. So I'm like, holy shit, this guy's my fucking hero, you know? But I met him at the Psychedelic Solution show. He had an art show in 89. So that was a Psychedelic Solution where it was like the first time Pusshead had a bunch of his originals, and he was there. And that, this was at the same time Metallica had that video for One. So they were playing that all the time everywhere. And then they were playing it at the art show, and I met him. Rob Zombie was there, and everybody was all about the artwork. So I really got to see that, his stuff up close. And to see it without any, like, white out or any correction fluid, you know? It's just kind of like, who draws this way?
All right, pause head.
So, so I got to meet him, and he signed, you know, autographs, and I asked him what was any advice that you can give an aspiring artist.
Yeah,
he's like, well, get into silk screening, and because you can make money off of that. And I had no interest in silk screening, but you know, at least it was, I took a class in school and kind of learned how to do it. But I was more into like storytelling. I wanted to tell stories. I wanted to draw comic books. And so I went to like SVA for storytelling, and I met a lot of people who were really good at it, and I met some people who ended up being big stars, and I learned that's, you know, I couldn't do that. I was really good at like one spot illustration, but let led into tattooing.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I mean, at some point, you got, you know, you want the guys who actually wound up playing in bands.
Yeah.
And things like that. And, you know, I mean, you went to the high school, what, in Jackson Heights?
Art and Design in Manhattan.
Art and Design, but you grew up in...
In Astoria.
Yeah. All right, so you got to know a lot of those guys.
Yeah.
You know, and at that point, were you a tagger at any point? For a brief time, maybe?
Maybe.
Listen, the statute of limitations are over at this point. It's usually 8 years. What?
What do you think, Chicken? I wasn't good enough to be a tagger.
It was one of those things you just didn't want to really get into. You kind of did it a couple times and eh.
I was more into the black books. You know, I had some friends. Well, a lot of friends. A lot of my friends are into doing like subways and
yeah.
Getting up on the walls, you know. And that was really cool, but I just couldn't. It wasn't my thing. I was more into just drawing characters, not letters, you know. But I saw a whole world in that, and which was really cool.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, did that influence, because you've also drawn quite a few fucking t-shirt design, poster designs, mm-hmm. and I think there might have been a couple album designs out of that as well, or
yeah.
album art at least. I mean, how did that come about?
I was asked by, what was the first thing I did? I was actually, the first big thing was Sick of It All. And that was, they asked me to draw a t-shirt design when Just Look Around came out.
All right.
Yeah, so that was kind of a big deal. And I was really excited to be asked to draw something that was gonna be on a t-shirt. I had no idea about the business. I had no idea how to make money off of your artwork. So that was my kind of first, like, big step into like that kind of that artwork.
Yeah.
So that was really cool.
And you wound up drawing actually the Madball.
I drew the original,
you know,
Madball
for the Roadrunner release, I believe.
Yes.
Yes. You know, and that. You know, because I've seen your work with Madball, I've seen Crown of Thorns,
mm-hmm.
you drew some things for them. Murphy's Law, I believe?
Murphy's Law.
You know.
A few of them.
And a couple of other things I've seen, you know, dibs and dabs over, mm-hmm. you know, like, if you're a hardcore shirt guy, you probably have one of his fucking designs in your drawer. You know, it's just, you know, the way it is. Because there's really not a lot of guys who do that stuff.
Mm.
You know, it's... The guys who, you know, like, for instance, like Ernie Prada,
mm-hmm.
you know, he has a specific style he
yeah.
does. He does a very cartoonish style.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've had him actually, I've commissioned him for when Fahrenheit did our last show. I was like, dude, make me, you know, 40 posters on silkscreen, which he did a fantastic job. I just gave him kind of an idea. He ran with it, sent me something back. I was like, that works.
That's cool.
You know, and yeah, it was... You know, it was just, again, something to have. I'm always into the rare items,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
to so speak, numbered rare items, like, here you go.
Really collect your stuff. And that kind of got me excited about this, about that scene, the music scene. I mean, I grew up looking at Sean Taggart stuff.
Yes.
You know, even Mad Mark Rude. You know,
the
Misfit stuff.
Yeah.
You know? All that pen and ink stuff. I mean, this stuff that, like, you look at this, the album art while you're listening to the records, you know?
Yeah.
And you look at all the little details, all the stuff that you kind of miss out on. It's really exciting. So that kind of inspired me. My stuff, I never thought my stuff would go this way, you know? So into that, right?
It's still with Holsis.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still out there, you know? Fucking people still love a lot of that stuff that's... Mm-hmm. been out there in a lot of those bands, and it's even funnier because I think for the most part you've tattooed just about every hardcore guy on the fucking planet at this point. Everyone from fucking AF all the way to fucking Madball, Sick of It All, you know, there isn't anybody out there you've actually haven't touched with your needle, mm-hmm. you know, which is kind of interesting, you know, to a degree. You know, it's like, wow, who's celebrity wise and not hardcore wise, but do you ever tattoo someone famous?
Have I? Probably.
Oh, you don't talk about it. That's fine. We'll leave it at that. You know, but I mean, did you ever, you know, what was your first hardcore show that you remember going to?
I remember it was a long time ago. It was AF, Agnostic Front, opening for Slayer.
Really?
At the Ritz. I think it was 85.
Wow.
Yeah. It was, I think, what was that? Zoetrope? Is that how you pronounce it? Zoetrope? Z-O-E?
Not really sure.
So, I think it was them, AF, and then Slayer. So, that was my first experience. I was really young, too. So, I was, like, going with some friends, and it was just like, yo, this is intense. This is, you know, scary. You know, you go to Slayer show, and you see upside down crosses and lights flashing.
Was that your first like show experience?
Yeah,
really. Much. that's actually pretty interesting, because usually everyone I've ever talked to, usually they've gone into arena rock.
Oh yeah.
You know, I saw something at the Garden or Nassau Coliseum.
That's the first experience.
You know, and then that's a pretty fucking heavy first experience. Like, yeah. I saw Slayer.
And it's like Gnostic Front. You know? At the Ritz.
Oh, God. And that's the old Ritz on the, old Ritz, the Webster Hall Ritz.
Webster Hall, yeah.
You know, before they switched it over. Oh, my God.
So I was, like, kind of blown away. I was like, I don't know what to expect. I was deaf. You know, so.
Oh my God.
So that opened a whole new world for me. And then, and still, Slayer's still playing to this day. You know, yeah. I see Slayer every time they've come to New York, you know? And what's even cooler is that we have friends that
work with them
in their circle. So it's pretty cool.
And it's funny because the friend we have, which, you know, we have a friend, Warren Lee, he's an old hardcore guy.
Yeah.
He wound up being Jeff Hanneman's guitar tech. When Jeff passed, he switched over to Gary Holt. He was Kerry King's for a little while, too. And he's been with them for about, 17 years now, I think it is. And it's amazing to think, it's like, wow, you know, one of our own, you know, like,
isn't that thing.
And it's like, there was about a year or two ago, there was a show called Premier Guitar that's on YouTube. Mm-hmm. You know, it's for gear nerds. And, you know, Gary Holt had Warren come in to explain his, like, rig. And I'm like, holy fuck, I know that fucking guy. He used to be my tour manager eons ago. It's just like, you know, it's just kind of funny that, like, how things come full circle. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you never thought, like, oh, Slayer, you know, I'll never meet those guys.
Right,
you know,
we've all
met them at this point.
Right.
But it's just like, holy shit, I remember that fucking shit. So what made you want to own a shop?
It just turned out that way. You know, I worked at Flyrite. I started there in 1999. And there was a really good crew that worked there. Elio Espana, he owned the shop. And he ran a really kind of a tight ship. To a point, as far as people that worked in there, I guess you had to cut the mustard. You know what I mean? You had to be good. You couldn't
fucking be a half ass.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, you needed a, and the people that worked there were really good. So you kind of like, I was nervous when I actually got a job there, because these people, you know, you kind of have to be like, oh shit, I gotta, you know, bring my shit.
Your A game has to be on point.
My A game, exactly. And,
by the way, people, Chicken is doing what the fuck he wants right now.
He's the real cameraman behind all of this.
He's just shifting cameras. It's all right. But, I mean, is there ever a point where you kind of wish to yourself, like, fuck, can I just go back to being a shift guy and not being an owner? I mean, I'm sure there's a whole other responsibility. You know, now you're the guy.
Yeah.
You know, like, I'm sure there's, you know, when things go wrong, now it's your ass.
Oh, yeah. So, it's, all right, so it's like another job.
Yeah.
It's totally different, you know, you gotta wear a different hat. I mean, my passion is always to the art, to the tattoo, to your client,
you know?
But your responsibility as the owner, your responsibility as, you have to lead the example of be the, you know, everyone's watching you. But the thing is, you have, well, I have a really great crew of people that I work with, who are adults who want to work, who want to be there, and they're very serious about their tattooing and the business. So I have a lot of trust that I give to them, and because they want to be there, they want to make sure Fly Right is as good as it can be, you know.
How has that neighborhood changed since you worked there? Because I remember just going there probably about maybe 99, 2000 around the time you started working there, and wound up bringing my father with me.
Yes.
You know, and
he's one of my favorite people.
And I remember I went with him once, I think, to one of his appointments, and you had told me, like, I've never seen anybody get a tattoo on their plex and not flinch. You know, he got it right here, and he just sat there like fucking nothing, and I was like, and he was probably about, I don't know, maybe 59, 60 at that point, you know, it was like, wow. You know, I was very impressed with the old man myself. You know, like wow, he could take fucking paid.
Yeah.
You know, because anyone who knows who's gotten tattooed by you, you know, you tend to be, what's the nickname? Heavy hand? You know, where you sit there and go, fuck, I'm just going to stare at that spot on the wall. I'm not moving. You know, because if I move, it's going to take longer. You know, it's just like, just get it done. Just get it done. I'll deal with the fucking pain. But yeah, well, I mean,
Heavy Hand was a nickname my friend gave me back in 97. His name is Mariano. He's I used to work with him. He's from Argentina. So at the time, my machines were really loud. It's just the way this one machine was, and it just sounded crazy. It was tuned okay. You know,
just loud,
and it wasn't consistent, so it sounded crazy. It's like, so he was like, Huie, I'll call you Heavy Hand from now on. So we made a cartoon, and it said Heavy Hand on the shirt. It was basically a caricature of me with this giant hand.
I've seen the artwork,
right?
Yeah, I've seen it.
So that name stuck. For years to this day, and he goes, hey, Heavy Hand. So when social media started, well, when computers started coming out, and they asked for like a username, and the first thing that came to me was Heavy Hand. So I started using that. And then when social media started happening, like MySpace, or Friendster even, you know, I was like, I don't want to be on this thing. And friends are like, you got to do it. Your name should be Heavy Hand. Okay, so it stuck. So, and then that name stuck. So when it came to tattooing, people were like, "Oh shit, you're Heavy Hand. You're Heavy Hand."
You've actually gotten a lot lighter over the years. You have. Well, you know, I will admit that. Because when I first started going to you like 20 years ago, I was like, "Ow, ow, 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 fuck!" You know, compared to other people I've been tattooed by, it's like, oh. This guy's a pussy. Steve's like, ah.
Are you ready? All right, you're ready.
You know, or occasionally he's like, oh, what? Steve did this to me a couple of times where he's like, oh, you're falling asleep? Jab you a fucking little bit, you know, just to make sure you're up.
Or, did you eat before you came?
Yeah, did you eat? It was fucking terrible. But yeah, like I said, my, I remember how, I got turned on to it. Like I said, it was one of my guys, and then, you know, my father starts seeing my work that I was bringing home, and he was just like, it's like, yo, this is good shit. I want to go. You know, like, yeah, let's go. You know, and he went for a handful of pieces. And I remember when he got sick, you had done some neck pieces for him.
Mm-hmm.
They had to put a tube in his neck. And he was so fucking pissed off that they had, he's like, don't go around the fucking tattoo. Go around the tattoo. And they had to fucking jab it right into, and he was like, he was more pissed about that than actually having to have a fucking tube stuck in his neck. He's like, you gotta fuck my fucking tattoo up. And it was like, you know, I mean,
oh man,
yeah, it was fucking kind of like one of those funny, sad moments. Right, right. He's just like I feel bad he's having this done, but at the same time, that's pretty fucking hysterical. He's worried about his fucking tattoo. The guy's dying, you know, and it's like don't fuck my tattoo up, you know. And that was his whole fucking thing always.
I love that he had a nickname for me.
Oh,
egg.
Well, all right, I have to explain this about, and there's some people who know me and that watch this are gonna know that I'm sort of like my father, where totally. I don't give a fuck.
Right.
You know, mm-hmm. It's just, I it's not that I don't, you know, I hate people or whatever. It's just like, to me, a nickname is a term of endearment.
Yeah.
You know, I will poke fun at your fucking, at you as a person, at your race, at your religion. It doesn't fucking matter, you know, because everyone is the same fucking person at
right.
the end of the day. And that's how he looked at it. He, you know, I would meet guys who, you know, especially island guys who worked with my dad's like, your father crazy, man. And it's like, you know, it's like you don't gotta explain, I already know where you're going with this, you know.
But if it came up the name for you,
yeah,
that's cool. That's awesome, you know?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, it's the same shit with me. I have nicknames and I go after people for fucking different things as well. It just, you know, if I don't like you, I just won't talk to you.
Right.
You know, I won't even associate with you. I'll just, you know, next, get out of my fucking face. You know, what's Eve's in the shop as far as customers? Like, when they, you know, I'm sure there's a certain thing that, like, where you go, oh my god, this guy is really pissing me the fuck off. Like, what is your pet peeve in the shop when you're tattooing somebody?
When I'm tattooing somebody, let's see, when they move.
Well, that's an obvious one.
But sometimes when they ask the same question over and over again.
Like, what kind of question?
You know, like, oh, is this, what color is this gonna be? You know, or in the last second, they're like, oh, can you throw in a name? When the design's already done. I'm like, almost done.
Like, you already
outlining, you know? Oh, can you add, like, this date or this name, like, right here? I just throw it in there whenever you want, you know? No! It's something you should have told me in the beginning, you know?
Well, they also don't realize, I mean, you know, I'm sure people think, you know, as a tattoo, I was like, well, you're sitting down all day. No, your fucking hands and your back.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and I've heard, it's not, you're not the only person I've ever heard about back problems from, you know, just like leaning over all day. Well, you know, you do that for 20 plus years, it starts.
Okay. Oh, I wear glasses now.
Oh, Jesus Christ, you're going blind?
Well, you know what? It's crazy because for all these years, I was pretty proud of, like, oh, I don't have to wear glasses. I'm the only one in my family that never needed to wear glasses. And then I started, like, squinting. Because, you know, you're like this all day long tattooing. And then, like, I remember, like, some guy at the doorway, it'd be like, hey, Steve, you know? So I look up and it's blurry.
Uh-oh.
I'm like, ah, it's begun. So it happened for a while. I'm like tattooing close up, and it takes a while to adjust to see who the hell's talking to me. So, all right, so I have to go to the eye doctor, and they're like, you know what you have, right? I'm like, wow, what? And they're like, you have old eyes. So I'm like,
oh my god.
Alright, so now I have to wear glasses while I tattoo. And I'm so glad I do, because I can't tattoo, you know.
But you got away with it for this long.
For this long, you know.
So, you know what, that's not a bad thing.
After tattooing over 20-something years.
Yeah.
You know, now I need glasses. All right. You know, I am 44 now, so.
Yeah, it's a body.
And the prescription's not that strong, so it's, you know, I'm still holding on to my youth.
There's a, we have an interesting thing in common, besides obviously the tattoo thing, my father, music.
Yeah.
We've both worked for Rockstar Games
yeah.
for a brief moment, and your brother actually still works for Rockstar Games.
Yeah, he's still there.
You know, and I just want to tell one story, and then we're going to talk about something else. I remember years and years ago, I used to know, you know, the president, Sam Houser. I just don't want to really get into too much about it. And one day I had to go to the office for something. And I remember walking past a fucking hat coat rack thing. And I go, there's about 30 controllers hanging on this coat rack. And I go, you know, in all different states of disrepair. You know what I mean? Some don't look like they're broken at all. Some of them are literally split in the middle. Other have electronics hanging out. Some of them are just a cord. Mm-hmm. You know? And I go, fuck is that? I was like, oh, that's Richie. You know? And Sam opens up the door. He's like, this is why we keep a stock of controllers in the thing. And I was like, what does he do? He's like, he gets pissed off.
He gets mad.
At the time, his brother was, I mean, what does he do now at that?
He's what do you call it? A lead analyst, which is like basically a game tester.
Yeah. Well, at that time he just started like he may have been working there for a year change.
Yeah.
At that point, and you know they loved him, and it was like a guy with fucking Tourette's. You would just, from what I heard what I heard from Sam and other people who worked in the office, especially like Jen Colby, is like it would be very quiet, and you'd hear fuck, and you'd hear smash, you know, and then you'd go to the closet, you'd get another controller, and calmly just start playing the game again, you know, because a lot of people think video game testing is.
Oh, it's easy.
Yeah, you know, it's easy. I just play games all day. No, when you have a bug that you're working on for like 8 hours, you know.
It's a job to find
it. It's a job. It's a job to find these bugs.
And he's very passionate about his job.
No, and he should be, because it's I remember years ago I asked Sam for a fucking job, just, you know, knew him, and he was like, I like you. I don't want to give you a job because I like you. You know, and I was like, fair enough. I understood what he meant. You know, so I was like, okay, no problem. But you did some voiceover. Well, actually, your first foray into that was they used your back piece.
All right.
They used your back piece on for the PlayStation 2 version of Grand Theft Auto.
Yeah, for Grand Theft Auto 2.
Yes.
Okay, and I started my back piece tattoo. It was just an outline. And I remember I was like really excited about it. But they had a theme in Grand Theft Auto 2 where they had Yakuza.
Yes.
Okay. And they wanted to do an ad campaign surrounding like Yakuza, and they're like, oh, you have a back tattoo. Can we use you in the campaign? And I remember they took a photo of my back and they had like Grand Theft Auto 2 and they had respect. Is everything.
And actually, it was
in the package.
Yeah, it was in the package. I remember that. And the thing I just remember about that was like you wound up going to you wound up doing what, voiceovers for what was it, GTA 4? The New York City one?
GTA, I think it was GTA 3 and GTA 4, which was Vice City.
Yes.
You
played the kid selling drugs on the radio.
Yeah. That was one of the characters.
Yeah.
Because I also did other ones where I was the guy getting shot. I was the guy getting run over. I played Yakuza.
Yeah.
It was awesome.
Yeah, because I remember I finally got my shot at it, and I got to do, like, the bumpers for the Liberty City Hardcore.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, thing. They were like, well, we want you to do bumpers. So it was me and my friend Pete and Armando hand us a script, and they're like, you know, we brought like a half a drum set down and a little guitar amp, and you know, got kind of thrown into a vocal booth, a voiceover booth with equipment, and we're just like, well, we want this, okay. You know, we did like I think 11 or 12 of them, and, you know, wound up overdubbing vocals. And I just remember to this day, you know, if, I mean, I haven't played that game in a while, but it was one of those things where you go, wait, that's me? Because you tend to forget about that you did it, you know? It's like, I actually remember more the fact of signing a phone book of paperwork after I did it, like, sign there.
You're not even reading it.
Yeah, just stack. like, I think I gave him my liver and possibly my firstborn, you know? But it was kind of, like, cool to fucking, like, be a part of that, yeah. You know? I mean,
that's a big deal. Grand Theft Auto was pretty big hit.
Yeah, know? No, and the funny thing was, I didn't really tell anybody about it. I just did it, and I forgot about it. You know, it was like one of those things, like, oh, that was cool, you know, I did this, you know, got a nice little check from it. And, like, I remember, like, when it finally came out, I didn't really, you know, I'm not one to brag at work about stuff, and guys would fucking come up to me, and they'd be like,
oh, that's you?
No, and they saw my name in the fucking credits, and they're like, wait, are you the same? It's like, oh yeah, I did that. And I was like, yeah, why? It's like, yo, I would have blew this up. It's like, it's not really what I do. It's not really what I do. But, I mean, is there any words that you could give to, like, a starting tattooist at this point?
At this point, just don't.
Seriously, just don't, or?
Well, it's... The information is there.
Yeah.
It's way too easy to break into this now. You know, it's really, it's tough because everyone is doing it and everyone is really easy to think that it's gonna get you rich quick. It's gonna get you fame. It's gonna, you know, it's not, you know. I mean, there's a lot of hard work into this. If you really want this to work, you really gotta have the love of tattooing. Make sure you get tattooed, you know. Make sure you know the history. It's a big deal. You have to respect the history to respect the craft. Nowadays, a lot of people don't care. You know, it's just like an easy way to kind of make money and to kind of be like, oh, I can tattoo and I can travel. I can.
They see the glamour, they don't see the work.
Yeah, it's a lot of work. It's a lot of work that's not taken for granted. You know, people take it for granted.
Yeah,
basically, just. Just there's other ways to get what you want besides tattooing. You know, leave it to the guys who do love it, you know, who's been in the game for 20 something years, you know. Yeah.
Well, in other words, guys, go get a real fucking job.
Oh yeah.
Steve, it was a pleasure.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
If you're an artist, a musician, or someone who has something interesting to say or has a story, go to the description below, email us. We will have conversations, we'll have cocktails. If you're not into cocktails, we'll have coffee. If you're not into coffee, we'll do whatever the fuck you want to do. I really don't give a shit. Don't forget to subscribe and hit the like button. Don't hit the like button. I don't give a fuck.